Hello friends, in this video we will discuss about the intraoral examination, various diagnostic aids, pre-prosthetic surgical options and prosthetic option for a complete denture patient. So under intraoral examination we need to examine the oral mucous membrane, maxillary and mandibular arches, palate, tongue, floor of the mouth, bony abnormalities and saliva. Coming to the color of the mucosa, so the normal and healthy mucosa is pink in color, and in case of inflammation it appears red. So the common prosthetic causes of irritation include overextension of the periphery of the denture, and this results into the hyperplasia of denture border tissues, and this condition is known as epulis fissuratum. Then dirty ill-fitting dentures causes inflammation of the underlying mucous membrane, continuous wearing of dentures and faulty occlusion also results into the inflammation and hyperplasia of the denture bearing area. Then rubber suction disc, these discs results into the negative pressure under the denture and further hyperplasia and inflammation of the mucous membrane. Other causes are traumatic injury, small spicules of alveolar bone, or conditions like carcinoma and mucosal conditions like lichen planus. Then according to Haus, the mucosal condition can be classified into healthy, irritated and pathologic mucosa. The quality of the mucoperiosteum may vary within each arch. Tissues may be extensively thin in one area where teeth have been missing for a long time and normal where teeth were removed recently. Other areas may be excessively thick with localized regions of redundant tissue. When tissue thickness varies, special problems are created. Such variations make it difficult to equalize pressure under the denture. So according to Haus, the mucosal thickness can be classified into three classes. Class 1 includes normal uniform density of mucosal tissue, that is approximately 1 mm thick. Investing membrane is formed but not tense and forms an ideal cushion for the basal seat of a denture. In case of class 2, the soft tissues have thin investing membranes and are highly susceptible to irritation under pressure, or the soft tissues have mucous membrane twice the normal thickness. In case of class 3, the soft tissues have excessively thick investing membranes filled with redundant tissue. At the very least, this requires tissue treatment. Such conditions may require surgical correction. Coming to the arch size, it tells about the support available for complete dentures. According to Haus, the arch size can be classified into three classes. Class 1 is large arch, which is best for retention and stability. Class 2 is medium arch, which is good for retention and stability. And class 3 are small arches, where the retention and stability is difficult to achieve. Then arch form, it provides an estimation of teeth size and arrangement. So the opposing arches may not have the same form, so one can anticipate some difficulty in teeth arrangement. According to Haus, the arch form can be square, tapering or ovoid. Then maxillary ridge form, so again it can be classified into three classes. Class 1, where the maxillary ridge is square to gentle rounded. This is the ideal ridge form. It provides resistance against lateral and vertical displacement. The height of ridge resists lateral displacement and parallelism of ridge resists vertical displacement. Then class 2 is tapering or V-shaped ridge. There is little resistance to vertical displacement in case of class 2 ridges. And class 3 flat ridges, it provides little resistance to lateral displacement. Then mandibular ridge form, again it can be classified into three classes. Class 1 is characterized by inverted U-shaped ridges. There are parallel walls from medium to tall with broad crust. And class 2 ridges, inverted U-shaped ridges with short walls with flat crust. Then class 3 ridges are characterized by unfavorable inverted W-shape or short inverted V-shaped or tall thin inverted ridges, or ridges with undercut, which results from all teeth in labial or lingual version. Coming to the ridge relationship, so it tells about the anterior-posterior relationship of maxillary residual ridge relative to mandibular ridge when jaws are in centric relation. So according to angle, it can be classified into three classes. Class 1 is normal ridge relationship. Class 2 is characterized by retrognathic mandible, and class 2 by prognathic mandible. A prognathic mandible often places unfavorable stresses on the maxillary basal seat area. Then ridge parallelism. So in case of class 1, both ridges are parallel to the occlusal plane. In case of class 2, the mandibular ridge is divergent from the occlusal plane anteriorly. And in case of class 3, the maxillary ridge is divergent from the occlusal plane anteriorly, or both the ridges are divergent anteriorly. The ridges that are not parallel to each other will cause movement of denture base when teeth occlude because of unfavorable direction of forces. Then interarch space. So in case of class 1, it is ideal to accommodate the artificial teeth. In case of class 2, the interarch space is excessive. And in case of class 3, the interarch space is insufficient. Border attachments according to House. In case of class 1, the border attachments are high in medulla or low in mandible in relation to ridge crust. So it is approximately 0.5 inches or more between the level of attachment and crust of ridge. This is the most favorable situation. In case of class 2, the attachment height in relation to ridge crust is between 0.25 to 0.5 inches. And in case of class 3, the attachment height is less than 0.25 inches from the ridge crust. Then frenum attachments according to House. In case of class 1, the frenum attachment is high in maxilla or low in mandible in relation to crest of ridge, and this is the most favorable situation. In case of class 2, the frenum attachment is medium, and in case of class 3, the frenum encroach on the crest of the ridge and may interfere with the denture seal. Coming to the soft palate, the flexure which the soft palate makes with the hard palate and the width of the palatal seal should be recorded according to House. In case of class 1, the soft palate is horizontal and there is little muscular movement. This is the most favorable condition and it results into wider palatal seal. In case of class 2, soft palate makes an angle of 45 degrees to the hard palate. The potential tissue coverage is less than class 1. In case of class 3, the soft palate makes a sharp angle of approximately 70 degrees with the hard palate. The available space is minimum. It is usually associated with a V-shaped palatal wall. In these cases, placement of seal and its depth is critical, and denture base impingement may result into soreness and loss of border seal and gagging. Then palatal sensitivity. In case of class 1, it is normal. In case of class 2, it is subnormal or palate is hyposensitive. And in case of class 3, it is supernormal or palate is hypersensitive. Coming to the tongue, according to House, it is of normal size, development and function in cases of class 1. In case of class 2, the teeth have been absent for a long time, which permits the changes in form and function of tongue. In cases of class 3, the tongue is excessively large, which creates problem in impression making and it results into the decreased denture stability. Tongue position according to Wright. In cases of normal, the tongue fills the floor of the mouth confined by the mandibular teeth, lateral borders rest on occlusal surface of posterior teeth, and the apex rests on incisal edges of the anterior teeth. In case of class 2, the tongue is retracted, the floor of the mouth is pulled downward, lateral borders raised above the occlusal plane, and the apex is pulled downward into floor of the mouth. And in case of class 2, the tongue is retracted, the tongue is very tense and pulled backward and upward, floor of the mouth is raised and tense, apex is pulled back into body of the tongue, lateral borders rest above the mandibular occlusal plane. Then floor of the mouth. The relationship with the crest of ridge is crucial in determining the prognosis of mandibular denture. If the floor of mouth is close to the crest, the magnitude of movement is more and retention and stability is poor. It can be measured with a Williams probe. to write. It interferes with the speech. It adversely affects the posteropalatal seal, and it results into the hampered stability. In case of class 1, the tori is absent or minimal in size. It do not interfere with denture construction. In case of class 2, the tori is of moderate size. It results into the mild difficulties in denture construction in use. And in case of class 3, the large tori are present. It requires surgical recontouring or removal. Then bony undercut, mostly present lateral to the medullary tuberosity or in the anterior ridge areas. It may cause some loss of border seal, and it is more judicious to relieve denture than surgical correction of the undercuts. Coming to the saliva, in case of class 1, the saliva is of normal quality and quantity. In case of class 2, there is excessive salivary secretion which is rich in mucus, and class 3 is characterized by xerostomia, and the remaining saliva is mucinous in nature. Excessive salivation creates problem in impression making, so in these cases atropine sulfate can be given orally to reduce the salivary flow. Excessive secretions of mucus from palatal glands which distort impression material in posterior third of palate, so to reduce this it should be wiped with the gauze, or the palate can be massaged to empty glands, or an astringent mouthwash can be used. Coming to the various diagnostic aids, these include casts. Casts are used for evaluation of anatomical relationships, arch size and symmetry. Articulator mounted casts are used for jaw relationship and interarch tooth relationship and presence of undercuts. Radiographs are used for detection of any submucosal conditions, bone density, bone pathology, systemic disorders and resorption patterns. Radiographs can be extraoral or intraoral. Then pathological tests, reports of blood, urine, etc. are used for various systemic disorders, and pre-extraction photographs or records are used for tooth selection and arrangement, measurements of teeth and jaw relations. Coming to the treatment plan, it is the sequence of procedures planned for the treatment of a patient after diagnosis. So, treatment planning addresses the patient's need. It helps in listing specific treatment and specifies logical sequence. It enables patient to inform consent about the treatment, the time required for the treatment and fees, and it enables the dentist to estimate the operating time, the laboratory time and fees of the treatment. The various treatment options include, first is the adjunctive care. It includes elimination of any infection, elimination of pathosis, surgical improvement of denture bearing area, tissue conditioning and nutritional counseling. Patient education and counseling is required. So we need to inform the patient of their dental health and its significance, give the patient understanding of significance of edentulism, match the patient's expectations with reality of treatment potential, explain nature, use and shortcomings of prosthesis, and identify alternative treatments and their consequences. Coming to the pre-prosthetic surgery, so it includes non-surgical and surgical methods. Non-surgical methods are rest for the denture supporting tissues by removal of dentures or by applying temporary soft liners. Tissue abuse due to improper occlusion can be corrected by withholding the faulty dentures from the patient, correcting and refitting the denture by means of a tissue conditioner, or by substituting properly made dentures. Occlusal correction of old prosthesis is done to restore optimal vertical dimension of occlusion of the existing denture with an interim resilient lining material, and conditioning of the patient's musculature includes jaw exercises which permit relaxation of muscles of mastication and strengthen their coordination. Then surgical methods. These methods condition that preclude optimal prosthetic function, like localized or generalized hyperplastic tissues, unfavorably located frenulal attachments, pendulous maxillary tuberosity, bony prominences, undercuts and ridges, and discrepancies in jaw size relationships, or in cases of enlargement of denture bearing area, various procedures like vestibuloplasty or ridge augmentation are done. Then various prosthetic options include conventional complete dentures, immediate dentures. The indications for immediate dentures are patients with periodontally weak teeth indicated for extraction, and for socially active people, self-conscious about their appearance. Then overdentures. The indications for overdentures are patients with few remaining teeth that may be healthy or periodontally weak with intact or grossly destroyed crowns, or patients with severely compromised dentition. Then treatment plan also includes choice of articulator, teeth selection, the shade, mold and material of the maxillary, anterior, mandibular, anterior, maxillary, posterior, mandibular, posterior teeth are selected, denture based material, microwave resin or heat cure resin, denture based shade, depends on the brand of acrylic, and characterization, it establishes the stains to be used, draw a map of the proposed stain placement. Then prognosis, it is a forecast as to the probable result of a disease or a course of therapy. Prognosis should be evaluated keeping in mind the consequences of treatment and no treatment, as to how such an action can change the prognosis. So prognosis can be classified as good, fair or poor. So if you like this